Now let's talk about the velocity of sound wave in a fluid. Now when we disturb a fluid, the pressure waves are created. Now these pressure waves, they move at a velocity of sound. So if you look at this, this is a rigid pipe in which you have a piston. So initially the piston is at rest. Okay, when you give the piston a slight movement towards the right by a distance x, a pressure wave is generated which moves ahead at a velocity of sound. So this is the wave front which is moving at a velocity of sound. So when you give it a distance, or you can say when you move it by a distance x, the pressure wave moves by a distance capital L, moving at a velocity of sound. Okay, so if you talk about the distance covered in a small time interval dt, which is same for the sound wave, the distance covered by the piston, let us say the piston is now moving with a velocity v. Okay, so x is equal to, or I'll write down first of all, distance covered in time interval dt. Okay, so for piston this is x, which is v into dt, speed into time. Okay, and for pressure wave this is L, which is c into dt. So these are the distances covered in the small interval dt. Now due to the compressible fluid, there will be a change in pressure because we are pressing it and there is the generation of a pressure wave, and there will be a change in the density also. So let us say before compression the pressure is p and the density is rho. After compression the density the pressure has become p plus dp, and the density will now become d rho plus rho, or rho plus d rho, whatever it is. Okay, now let's look at the continuity equation for this. So the mass of the fluid before compression for this much length, okay, so before compression mass for length L, this would be rho into area into length. Now this rho into area into length can be written as rho a into c dt, because L is equal to c dt. Now after compression mass for the length L minus x has to be found out, because now this much length is there is an increase in the density. So your mass would now become rho plus d rho into area into L minus x, and this can be written as rho plus d rho into area into c dt minus v dt. I can take dt common and we'll have rho d rho, this is rho plus d rho, rho plus d rho into c minus v into area into dt. Okay, so this is after compression and this is before compression. Now due to the continuity equation, that is the conservation of mass, the mass before compression and mass after compression have to be same. So this is equal to this. You will have rho a c dt is equal to rho plus d rho into c minus v into a dt. I can get rid of a dt from here, and we'll have rho c is equal to rho c minus rho v, rho c minus rho v plus c into d rho minus v into d rho. Okay, rho c and rho c gets cancelled, so you'll have c into d rho is equal to rho v plus v d rho. The d rho is already very low value, and velocity of the piston in comparison to the velocity of the pressure wave is also very low. So these two very less quantities being multiplied together can be taken as a zero value. So they can be neglected. So you'll have C d rho is equal to rho into velocity. So mark this equation as equation 1. Okay, so this was the law of conservation of mass for this travel. Okay, now let's talk about the pressure and the force analysis. So let me make a little space for writing over here. So if you look at the pressure force before the compression, before compression, okay, the pressure force will be equal to P into area. The pressure force after compression, that is after compression, the pressure force would be P plus dP into area. Now there is a change in the pressure force, which is equal to the rate of change of momentum, because that is the impulse momentum theorem. So you will have P plus dP into area minus P into area is equal to the rate of change of momentum, that is mass upon time into velocity. So you will have mass is how much? Rho A into L upon dt into V minus 0, because the initial velocity is 0. Okay, we can get rid of P and PA from here. You will have A into dp. This will be equal to rho into A. Now what is L equal to? L is equal to C into dt. So you will write down C over here and we can get rid of dt, and then you will have V over here. Okay, I can also get rid of A from here, which gives me a value of dp is equal to rho into C into V. Okay, now the value of, you know, these two quantities can now be used. So I can use a value, and for that I can get a value for C from this. So you will have C is equal to dp upon rho into V, and let me name that equation as equation 2. So now let's multiply equation 1 and equation 2. When you multiply them, you get C square into d rho is equal to rho into V into dp upon rho into V. So rho into V and rho into V can be cancelled, and you will get a value which is C square d rho is equal to dp, which gives you C square is equal to dp upon d rho. So from here I can get a value for the velocity of sound, which is C is equal to under root dp upon d rho, and that is what we intended to find, that is the velocity of sound wave in a fluid. Okay, so this is the expression that we use to calculate the velocity of sound in a fluid of density rho, which is compressible in nature as well. So after this, let's now find out the velocity of sound in terms of the bulk modulus.